Yeah, so hi, thank you so much for for letting me speak and present.
Can you speak a little bit louder?
A little bit louder. So is it?
No, my key is just for me.
Okay, so that's for, I see. Yes, so let me go to the introduction. And basically, I'd like to introduce myself and the center. I work at NURMED. It's a Norwegian Center for Mental Disorders Research. It has four big domains. So we work in genetics of the psychiatric disorders. We work with brain imaging. That's another big domain. And there are two large clinical departments, which are like probably more than half of the employees at NURMED working with antipsychotic medication and outcome prediction. Right? So what we will talk about today is about genetics. So this part here. And the reason why I'm so interested in genetics is because we can apply lots of really interesting mathematical models to that data. And my background is, so it's like you said, it's Faculty of Medicine here. I'm actually like zero medical background for myself. I'm coming from the Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology. I worked in software for a couple of years, so just coding and doing some applied mathematics. My PhD with Vorontsov was in the theoretical backgrounds of machine learning, so we study overfitting of the, like once we feed the model, it always performs worse in the independent set. And it's really interesting to bring this kind of knowledge into the medical domain and try to see what's actually wrong with the patient struggling from psychiatric disorders, because it's not nearly obvious. Whatever technology we apply, from DNA to brain imaging, the brain looks surprisingly normal. The DNA looks surprisingly normal. We really don't know what's wrong. So, but we know it's heritable. We know from twin studies that schizophrenia is highly heritable. There was a case when basically all four identical twin daughters were sick with schizophrenia, so suggesting that it must be some genetic component. And roughly 80% of schizophrenia risk is estimated to be due to genetics. So that's why we're interested. And so basically on this slide, I'm showing the how we believe the complex human traits looks like. And complex here basically means polygenic. It means that a lot of genetic variants are involved in the genetics. You know, we are humans, so we have 23 chromosomes, 23 pairs of chromosomes. And on chromosomes, we have these genetic markers, right? It could be A, T, C, and G, and I just can't remember how you spell all the full names for these four potential nucleotides. And it's quite identical, right? So if you compare these two kind of synthetic figures, it's really identical DNA, except for this single location, right, on a chromosome. So here you see the what's let me see the where it's pointing to. Right. So it's blue and yellow on top, and it's green versus red in the bottom, right? So that's a point of DNA here when we call SNP. So SNP is an abbreviation for single nucleotide polymorphism. It's a point in DNA when different people can actually have different DNA materials. Right? So this is a genetic variant that we are interested in. And like just imagine, okay, if we have one healthy person and one person who is schizophrenia affected, right? We could ask a question, is this because of this SNP? Right? Is it this specific SNP that is causing the disorder? But schizophrenia is not a Mendelian. By now we definitely know that throughout the whole genome, each chromosome has some risk factors, right? So having a sample of one and one doesn't really work for us. We actually need a larger sample to like look for statistical significance. For like given that we observe some difference in, let's say, in the variant A, it's normally G in healthy people. So we say that controls, these are healthy people, right? We have to collect large samples, and we see that in healthy people, this variant is normally G. But if you look at cases, then it's another single nucleotide polymorphism that we encounter like 50% of the times. So probably this one has something to do with the schizophrenia. And if you count frequencies of different DNA markers in a given location, then we can, for example, use exact Fisher test in this case to see whether the combination of the variants you could have is statistically different between your controls population and cases population, right? So that's kind of by doing that across the whole genome, we can see, okay, these markers of some locations on the chromosomes are associated with a phenotype. And you can also think of this in terms of like naive bias classifier, right? If you treat these genetic genetic variants as your predictor features, right, and your human trait as outcome, like schizophrenia or not schizophrenia, right, we can basically try to do a naive classifier which just independently looks at the features, right, and see whether this particular feature, what does it have to do with the disorder, and then kind of try to accumulate them together, right, it might not be even Bayesian, it can be any naive classifier that treats features one by one, right, so that's where we are, like, here. And so far I've been talking about, like, differences in groups, right? We have healthy people here, we have people with a disorder in the bottom, but like for the rest of the presentation, we'll actually look with what people call quantitative traits, like human height. You know, the tall people, tall parents normally have like tall kids, right? It's definitely heritable, but like exactly how it is heritable, like it's pretty interesting. So in our case, the very good example of the output will be the human height. If you go to the, I'll start some mathematics at last. So the,
what is the typical size of cases set and controls?
Yes, so if we're, nowadays it's approaching millions, really millions. So in case of, at least for example, the largest device on height is more than a million people, like, because it's easy to measure. Schizophrenia sample is a very large international effort led by a psychiatric genomic consortium, and the previous release, it was 43,000 cases. This year they will release something in the order of 100,000 cases. Because as you can imagine, we have 3 billion pairs. Not everything is, of course, involved, and like a lot of DNA material is similar across people, right? But still, the amount of points of DNA when there is a variation even within the human population in the order of tens of millions, and it's even larger in African population. But in European, it's if we count everything that is at least 0.5% of the people have a variation in a given DNA, we will end up with like 11 million markers, and like. Because it's so polygenic that nearly everything has something to do with the disorder, you can imagine what are the effects, right? So human height is probably between, 150 centimeters to 190, right? So it's pretty small range for so many variants. I think the largest genetic variant known for height is like less than 1 centimeter of effect for that variant. Mm-hmm. And then the bulk of the variants, if you look at like 50% percentile, is probably like in terms of 0.5 millimeter or even less. It's very hard to detect like the association from those variants. So we need a very, very large sample sizes to get anything. The amount of noise in this data is kind of the general theme I would like to kind of, I can't stress enough how noisy is this data and how difficult it is to get any sensible readout out of it. So back to our height, so we have this n is the number of individuals in the data set in the order of tens of millions or hundreds of thousands of people. M is the number of genetic variants in the, like, about 10 times larger at this point, around 10 million genetic variants. The y is our outcome, the phenotype vector or human height, right? And then, so I have this both, like, so I have a couple of formulas here. So on the left is just written down, and on the right is a matrix form. It's exactly the same, whatever you prefer to look at. So G is this genotype matrix. This is actually observed. Thanks to technology, it's not super expensive to get people genotyped, and we actually have access to the genetic features these days. So N individuals and M genetic variants. The beta is what we're really interested in. This is a vector of genetic effects, right? And then, of course, we have some kind of other non-genetic component, for example, environment or the non-linear part, right? So here we, for simplicity, we just, but every research so far on like complex human genetics is doing this linear model. So it's very hard to go for interaction between SNPs, between these genetic variants. It's the linear model is really like mainstream and good approximation to the So it's not just approximation, it's also, there are some biological reasons why we're only interested in linear modeling. Y is known, of course we can measure height, and now we can like get the lab to genotype people or sequence them and we know G, but we don't know much about the genetic effects, right? So that's what we're interested in. Yeah. A little bit more louder. Okay, really sorry. Okay,
yeah. You could use mic.
I can try. Yes. Oh, so that's an easy fix. Yes. So so once again, let me repeat, because that's kind of a fundamental. It's called simple additive genetic model. We just model a linear relationship between genetic features and the phenotype, and a beta is unknown vector of genetic effects that we would like to find. Like, we all know linear math, so like, why don't we just kind of do that? Right? Why don't we just invert the genetic matrix and try to? Yeah. So one thing is we have 10 million by 1 million, right? It's pretty large, and even technically, I think that's difficult. Right?
No, oh. It's also not square.
It's not square, so we can do pseudo inverse. Sorry, that was a typo. I can put it as typo. But also, it's like very low rank matrix, right? And the genetic features are highly correlated, and like, the amount of noise is just too much, right? So what people tend to do is, as I mentioned, a naive classifier, when we just look at one feature at a time. So if we introduce this genetic vector I mentioned before, right, so the genetic genetic variance for different individuals for a given marker, right? So it goes from 1 to n, that's how many individuals we have, and then for a given genetic variant, right? That is the column vector that we have, and we can just see the correlation between that vector and the phenotype, right? Whether what you know from genetics about a given SNP correlates with your phenotype vector, and that's your beta hat, just marginal one SNP kind of association study. It's really like proportional to the correlation, the Pearson correlation between phenotype and genotype, and it's a bit noisy. So we normally think work in terms of the statistical strengths of association. So if it would be better to write the t-statistic, right? Because that's a wild test. We take the estimate over the standard error of the estimate, and effectively it's like just the square n times the correlation. That's, of course, the larger sample size you have, the more statistically significant is your finding, and also the larger the correlation is, the better. Like, the larger is the effect, the better it is. So, like, so far, really, really simple. But can we actually say that this beta hat, which is a correlation between phenotype and genotype, has what it has to do with the underlying vector of the genetic effects? Like, since I call it beta hat, you would probably think that it's actually like an unbiased estimator of the beta, right? But that's not the case because of correlations, right? Because our genetic features turned out to be really, really correlated, right? So maybe I can show this, go to the correlations straight away. So if we have these SNPs and then look at the Pearson correlation across SNPs, right? Then it will be huge blocks of up to like 2,000 or 3,000 genetic variants large. Because, you know, on a chromosome, things are inherited together. Like the large pieces of chromosomes, of course, there is a crossing over that we used to do in the genetic algorithms in like optimization methods, right? Inspired by like crossing over in genetics.
Yeah.
But in humans, it's a pretty large chunks that we inherit from one parent. So the variants located close to each other tend to correlate. It's like this autocorrelation structure along the chromosomes. And it looks like blocks, right? So there are hot spots where chromosomes tend to break. However, there is like a hierarchical structure to it. I'm sorry for the colors. I can't really explain what the colors here mean. But it's more like you do see that these blocks, they are not like, this block seems to be quite separated from this one. But you can also imagine that there is a larger block like of this size. Here, so it's a complex autocorrelation structure along the chromosome, and
the more block the color, the highest correlation.
So not in this case. I should redo the. So it's a bit messy, but best not to like just kind of do a black white for this matrix.
Okay.
Sorry about that. That's just a figure I had. It's from a review paper. It's specific questions they asked, so not the best illustration here. As a result, if you go back right to what we like now we look at this z-scores, right, the correlation coefficients between genotype and the phenotype vector, it's possible to prove that they are again a linear combination of the underlying betas that we are interested in. It's kind of a theorem. So instead of working with the original problem, which was linear, we can just still work with exactly the same style of the problem, but it's now before the y vector had the length was n, the number of individuals. Now we have an observed vector of the length M, which is a number of genetic variants in the data set, right? And that now A is a rectangular matrix. It's M by M, right? We just looked at it on the next slide. It's a correlation matrix. How correlated are the genotype vectors? And so basically what we can kind of, I call it theorem because we can definitely, there is a proof that these correlations that we can measure, they are a linear combination of the underlying beta features. So the exact, the theorem is that the elements in the sparse matrix is some kind of a little bit adjusted genetic, a little bit adjusted correlation coefficient between the feature vectors. Could be a little.
So can we say that Z is less correlated than beta? Can you say that we're performing a kind of decorrelation, a kind of white?
Not necessarily. I think the correlation structure of Z matrix is very similar to the correlation structure of the features itself. It's more that instead of working with, okay, the main reason to go into that other space, like for I'm trying to explain it, like why we are doing it and why we put two kind of very similar mathematical tasks. But at the end, like we will now switch to the next topic is the mixer model, and then just either of these forms will be equally good to discuss what we are actually doing in terms of math. But the idea is that this was a domain of the sensitive data. The individual level data is very sensitive. No one wants people like the society to know their status, schizophrenia or not. And then the genetics data is also sensitive. Like, good luck anonymizing genetic data because it's like an anonymous fingerprint, right? It's the identifier, right? My DNA is me. Right. So, but in this space, there is no more N, right? It's all about M, which is a number of features, right? And the correlation matrix, like nobody, people okay with like the society knowing the correlation between the SNPs in the genome overall, because it's not about a given person. So, and basically that's the main reason to go from this domain into this one. And we made the task probably a little bit more challenging mathematically because the design matrix was like a million times 10 million and here 10 by 10. But it also became a lot sparser, right? Now this is actually just actually the block size, right? Just the blocks are roughly 2,000 SNPs at a time, right? So it's possible to store this correlation matrix highly efficiently because of the it's a sparse banded matrix, mm-hmm. right? And the exact shape how we transform from G to A, it's not so important, but basically that is like here the REG here was a correlation coefficient between the genetic features, right? So for two SNPs, if you have the vectors, then we can correlate them, and that's basically our A matrix with small adjustments. So that was basically like the introduction. What data do we have? We can observe Z and the design matrix, which is really huge, and then we are interested in betas and we can't invert, right? I hope so. Like, can I probably do this trick? Could you please raise your hands if you understood the like what's known and unknown in this equation? Yeah. So that's good. I can really reiterate it once more time because like the whole second part would be about solving this. It should be quite simple because it's a system of linear equations, right? Let's now, I know it's very difficult to get in the domain. So like really don't worry if you didn't fully understand how that is connected to the genetics data. I just thought I could really start this talk at this point and say, okay, we have known Y vector, we have known design matrix, we don't have anything, like we would like to find the betas, right? And the epsilon, you don't even need to write it in because in the linear, like if it's OLS, like overly defined OLS system, right? Okay, it's just, that's a normally distributed residual, right?
So in some sense, it's all about solving a large-scale linear regression problem.
Yes, yes. Let's boil it down to that, right? And now we're going into the model that we've published recently, and the model is pretty simple. Nothing we can surprise you with. It's a mixture prior. It's a prior where we say that only a small fraction of pi 1 percentage of the variants have non-zero effect. So it's probably weird. Like this term is just a normal distribution with zero variants. I could call it delta function of Dirac. Right, we just say that some variants, actually the bulk of them, have no effect. their betas are zero. So it's a sparse, it's not only the A matrix that is sparse, but it's also the solution that is sparse as well.
Is it a prior distribution? Is it prior distribution? Or
this is our prior distribution we would like to enforce on beta.
Just one clarifying question. Are you familiar with the spike and slab?
Yes.
Because
yes.
Exactly.
Yes. Okay. That is spike and slab. Yes. So and it's also zero mean, right? So that's quite important. That we don't know whether like our phenotypes are centered, right? I didn't mention that, but it was height, but of course we kind of center it, so it's zero mean, right? Now we obviously would like to write down the likelihood function in order to do the fit, right? So that we will spend some time. How do we compute the likelihood? Because, so basically we are interested in computing the likelihood over like given z, right? Given our vector of parameters. And like the reason why it's difficult in this case, right, is because just imagine if you have a sum of two. Just tell me if that's obvious, right? But I want to explain that. If you have a mixture of two normal distributions, and now you do a linear combination, then now you actually, the distribution at the end is a mixture of four normal distributions, right? Because depending on which branch it's coming from, each variable, right? So if you have three, it will be eight, and it's 2 to the power of k, where k is the number of things in your linear combination up here. So given that we are talking about the like SNPs of like 10 millions or even the block size of 2,000 for a given LD block, it's just not tractable, right, to get an analytical expression for the likelihood function. So at this point, I would like to ask, like, do you know some theories? Is there a name to this domain when people have a mixture distribution and then they do linear combinations of these probability density functions? Must be some theories. If not, that could be an interesting theoretical piece when we study, mathematically we study, an arbitrarily linear combinations of the mixture, two-component mixture of Gaussians.
There are some approximate methods for such kind of problems.
Mm-hmm.
There are some approximate methods for such kind of problems.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. For example, what I could think of is that we could try to reconstruct, say, approximate posterior distribution in some parametric family such as Gaussian and get something like assumed density filtering or expectation propagation. Something like this.
So let's compare that to what we've done, because we've spent 2 years doing that, like doing something with this problem, because we really believe that this is a good prior. And I will, like, that prior is pretty simple, but I will show you, like, now we're working on the next paper where the prior is a lot more complex. And like, of course, we just start with that. But
again, just to clarify, so you're using prior distribution over beta, which is fully factorized, component wise, right? And the component is a mixture of two Gaussians.
Yes.
Delta function plus some Gaussian.
Yes.
And if we factorize them, do we really obtain exponential number of Gaussians?
Yes.
I would think that we should obtain one direct function in multidimensional space plus one fully factorized Gaussian.
Not really. So because I can try to just put it. It's long enough. That's good. So where do we have markers to write on it? Yeah, this one. So let's just try to have it with
let's consider a normal pen. Two-dimensional case.
Yes.
Do you still have marker?
I don't have the marker. That's. But we have desk. Because that's something would be nice to write down. Because really, I'm
afraid there's no marker.
Thanks. So the idea is, let's say we have. Let's, for example, consider. A sum of two random variables, each having this shape, but let's assume that the pi is different. They are still independent, right? So they do factorize, but let's try a different pi one and pi two, in the two things we put in the linear combination, right? And a will be equal to one, right? Just this plain sum, right? So you're right. There will be one Dirac. right? With probability one minus pi one times one minus pi two. There also will be the one with sigma beta plus sigma beta one plus sigma beta two, and that will be the probability pi one times pi two.
Right.
But there will also will be like one minus pi one times pi two,
mm-hmm.
and one minus pi two times pi one.
Yeah, and there'll be product of delta function with respect to one dimension and Gaussian with respect to another dimension.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. So.
So kind of partly degenerate distribution.
Yes. Oh no, but it's still 1D, right? At the end, it's still 1D because we sum each distribution is like a function of one. It's a one, right? We don't do it in 2D in this sense. So we sum them as a random variables.
But then I do not understand what would be the third and fourth multiplier, which is the product of delta function times Gaussian.
It's a sum, right? So the way I
if it's a sum, again a sum of delta function centered at zero plus Gaussian, right?
Yes.
That would be just Gaussian.
The question is, depending on which branch it's coming from, branch of the probabilistic mixture,
uh-huh.
you have like the. So I think it's very, very simple. If we have 1 minus pi 1 and pi 1, and 1 minus pi 2 and pi 2, and we are interested in 1 minus pi 1 times normal distribution 0, 0, plus pi 1 normal distribution 0 sigma beta. Let's call it sigma beta 1, sigma 1 even, just sigma 1 square. Right? That's one random variable. And we would like to add to this random variable something else, 1 minus pi 2 of the same one, plus pi 2, 0, sigma 2 square. Right? So the problem is the result if we observe an observation from this branch, it still can come from either of these ones. So the way I can write, I mean, maybe we can write it differently, but the way I can write the result will be a mixture of all distributions with probabilities 1 minus pi 1, 1 minus pi 2 times normal, 0, 0, plus, right, so that would be this one, the product of,
mm-hmm.
right? So then it will be 1 minus pi 1 times pi 2, meaning that it came from this branch and that branch, right? So the variance will be 0 plus sigma 2, so 0 sigma 2, right? Then another 1 minus pi 2 times pi 1. And this time it's sigma 1. And then the most interesting component, which is like pi 1, pi 2, and then sigma 1 square plus sigma 2 square.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then if we add the third one, then suddenly we need to like consider all combinations, which branch of the probabilistic mixture it's coming from. So that's how it approaches this combinatorial.
And this will mean that the result in distribution over Z will be a mixture of exponentially.
Yes.
Yes. Many,
that was, yeah.
Okay, up to now it's clear. Although I still can't understand the last lines on your slide.
So the last lines is, if we can come up with some analytical way or the way to compute the distribution over z-score given our three parameters,
mm-hmm.
then we can, like, because we observe the z-score, we can, so z is observed. We have these numbers, right? So now we can do the max likelihood. We can,
yes, but it seems that's a bit unstandard problem formulation.
Mm-hmm.
Because up to now, maybe I understood something wrong, but up to now we established prior distribution over beta.
Yes.
And now we're trying to maximize our likelihood with respect to prior distribution over beta. Maybe this is just some.
So maybe I'm not not using the like the. So we will not introduce what like the Bayesian prior over the theta vector. That is so
okay.
We do it in the like probably in the non Bayesian sense
as
this in the frequentist way. So the
posterior. What is the max evidence way?
It's I call it max likelihood because.
No, you're right in a couple of slides, whether that's maximum evidence or not.
Can you please explain why is it a problem with a lot of Gaussians? Because we have means Gaussian as a prior, and we have Gaussian likelihood. So shouldn't it be like the posterior should be like just the mixture of Gaussians? Maybe I don't understand. I'm sorry.
Again, let us look at the first equation. So z is a linear combination of beta, of betas, right? And now we know that each beta has a distribution which is a mixture of two Gaussians. One is degenerate delta function at zero, and one is some zero mean non-degenerate Gaussian. And now we simply take linear combination. Yeah. We take linear combination of random variables, each of them, each of which is a mixture of two Gaussians, will end up with a distribution which is a mixture of exponentially large number of Gaussians, 2 to the power of m. Mm-hmm. So that's it.
Yeah.
And we'll have some difficulties in computing p of z j given theta.
Yes.
Because this is a mixture of exponentially large number of Gaussians.
At this particular moment, there is an obvious solution. Let's just add some hidden variable to our prior distribution to say from which component we have our beta.
Yes.
And just run the variation of EM. Why this is not the answer?
So yes, I think that's one of the. So you know, at this point, we are not really interested at. We are only interested in this fitting these three parameters, right? So whatever way we can compute the p of z given theta, right? From the, so I think that's what we are doing actually. Like on the next slide, what I called sampling approach is exactly that. We randomly sample which of the variants. Right, so okay, let's just for simplicity. If pi 1 is equal to 1, then we have no problem, right? Yeah. We no longer have the mixture. The result is just one single normal distribution. No problem at all, right? We just analytically. And that's the idea underlying a least squares regression method, 3,000 citations on the Nature Genetics. Really easy. Easy math. Lucky guys, right? What we know based on domain that basically it's a bad prior. The pi 1 equal 1 is a bad prior. Like, you know, I've complicated the task for ourselves by saying now we are going to model with this delta function plus the normal distribution, but it does fit the data a lot better. So, like, unfortunately, that one of the priors that we know is kind of working for our data. So let's work out the technicalities. And we thought that it's a nice idea to just do a sampling, right? Once we can guess, like, select, let's say, one subset of the variants that are coming from the pi 1 branch, right, then we can do the nice trick with pi 1, right? So then it will be the so here if we know the set of branches that contributed the variance to the result, then we can compute kind of in this fashion we can compute.
Can we be sure that this is unbiased estimate?
Well, what we know is that it does work in terms of the pure statistical properties. We never formally prove that it's an unbiased estimator. But in terms, like we can compute the expectation of this thing, right? We know that the expectation is correct. The expectancy of the z square distribution will be okay. Whether it like all moments are preserved, that I don't know. But at least the first moment, the second moment is okay.
Okay.
And in our simulations, we have to do around 20,000. So if we 20,000 times sample from the set of potentially of the non-zero betas, and so the difference is AYG, right? That is different across variants.
Yeah, sure.
If we just sample a subset, and then we can use kind of this simplistic formula. And by the way, could you tell me how to write it properly? Because like this sum is a mixture. It's a mixture of T, capital T distributions, each with, is they equally weighted, is equal weight, the 1 over T. And then I actually go for like normal summation. So I hope that's, it's a pretty large mixture distribution.
Okay, this is mixture distribution.
Yeah.
We know that the mean will be the same. It will be zero.
Yes.
Just as a mixture of exponential large number of Gaussians. But can we say something about the second moment? I'm not sure that.
Because it's zero means that the second moment will have the, like basically like we just drop n and that will be the variance, right?
Yeah.
So I think it will converge because our like if we really sample at random from here, then its second moment should be okay as well.
No, that's already not bad. So we have unbiased estimates with respect to the first and second moments.
Yes.
Do I understand correctly that if you know the hidden variables, numbers of your components, IDs of your components, then you can evaluate the density exactly?
Yes, if we know, but
so you can sample, you can in MCMC there is just like a trick when we can expand our space in variables, like add these latent variables and sample them also. Then you can evaluate your density exactly, and then you can just throw away these variables, and you will obtain like an estimate of your marginal distribution, like if you integrate it over these variables.
But you can obtain the samples from the distribution, not
yes,
the
but you want only samples because we just need only samples from these distributions.
I'm not sure because
of beta p sigma. Yes.
But we're going to optimize likelihood with respect to pi and sigmas, and to do that we need to know to have access to the density function, not just to the samples of the distribution.
But we are very interested if there is another way to fit this model, right? With respect to the hidden parameters, we would be very interested if we can. So another trick would be the convolution from the Fourier theory, right? Because in the spectrum, everything is pretty simple. We can just multiply, right? Because each of the things that we put in the linear combination, we know the analytical spectrum, right? So now just to what the three formulas on the top, they have nothing to do with our specific prior. It's just the general definition of the characteristic function, right? And then we are actually working with an even function, so we can just write it as a half finite integral and a cosine, right? So that would be our way of calculating the PDF of z at a given point, right? And then we have for because our I probably should rename to the same exactly the same linear combinations, but the characteristic function of a mixture is like a linear combination of the components of the mixture in this case. So the delta function is one and the normal distribution is this one. So for everything we put in the linear combination, it's also pretty trivial characteristic function. Then we can just multiply them, right? But
and this will correspond to what? To convolution?
To convolution.
And the convolution will correspond to the summation.
Yes. Yes. So that's another kind of it's a Fourier integral at a given point, right? Because we don't actually interested in the full distribution over we are not interested in PDF so this PDF across the entire like set of z values. We are interested in a given point to compute likelihood.
Yeah.
Right, so we don't want the like discrete Fourier transform. We just do the. We actually implemented this approach, and it was really, really nice. Sometimes outperforming, normally outperforming the previous sampling approach, with this one. But of course, it's pretty heavy because it involves the numeric differentiation. Right, so at the end, we need to do this differentiation. Let's like we use the curvature, like numerical algorithm to integrate, and then to compute each. Each time, each data point, we actually do a product of, like, of course, the matrix was sparse, so each time it's around 2,000 on average, but it's crazy amount of computations.
But wait a minute. After you multiply such characteristic functions, you again end up with an exponentially large number of items.
Right. Not really, because here it's a number. This time is a number, And we can, so we actually do numeric integrations straight away. It's like we compute the, so this this is no longer
at a particular two values according
yes.
to your curvature.
Yes, yes. So in this sense, it was a viable approach.
Nice.
Of course, insanely slow, but still faster than the previous one. And then there is a third idea, which like was really difficult to get to, so it's probably a bit more involved. The previous two were kind of straightforward ways of attacking this problem. This one was like, I spent some time working on it. So we can actually make a moment like the Kurtosis preserving approximation. We can preserve the fourth moment of the distribution. So we know the second and fourth, like of course, the first and third moment are zero because symmetric, and it's also not difficult to prove that third moment is also zero.
Third moment for Gaussian.
And
but here you have a mixture of Gaussians.
Of two. Just let's I think it's actually it's zero because the entire thing is symmetric. Just symmetry saves me in terms of convincing people where there is no skewness to the left or to the right in the distribution. It's all like it's even. It's a sum of even random variables, I think, should be even still.
Yeah.
So the two non-zero moments here is the second and the fourth, right? So we can do that for the betas, right? So beta here was the one with the prior mixture prior, the delta plus Gaussian, right? We can do that. And three is because that's a kurtosis of the Gaussian distribution, right? So there is no magic in terms of, like, if it's a mixture, then the expectancy is a mixture as well, just by straightforward definition. So basically here it's 3 sigma beta fourth power because that's a four. This one should be 4. It's a typo.
Yeah.
So then, interestingly enough, in this case, we can compute the... So if we, it's almost z that we looked before. It just I've dropped the plus epsilon. Let's just look at the this one. So it's possible to derive these formulas for the expectancy, like second and fourth moment, raw moment of the linear combinations of betas. I think we've only used the independency and zero mean variables in this case. So this probably, like, I didn't put, like, I think we won't have time to just go through all of the details, how do you prove this theorem. But it turns out that this, it's almost an excess kurtosis, right? Except excess kurtosis, by definition, is fourth row moment minus 3, right? I think that just minus 3, not minus 3 second row moment. So if it takes the fourth row moment minus 3 times the square of the second row moment, it feels like this is an excess kurtosis. Maybe people should have called this an excess kurtosis, but it's not, right? But let's just for the moment call it some kind of... Yeah, another excess kurtosis, right? It turns out that this thing is linear with respect to, like, even in the case of the mixture, this e of the delta fourth power minus 3 times the square of the variance is cumulative and linear because the same thing goes here under summation with fourth. We can compute it exactly, the fourth moment of the complex distribution of the z score. Even though there is an exponential number of the things in the mixture, we still get the fourth moment exactly.
Yeah.
Must be some kind of... We can't be the first ones to write this fact, I think. But it was pretty interesting when we figure out that we actually don't... Not only... The fact that we know the second moment is pretty straightforward. But the fact that we actually know the kurtosis, how heavy are the tails, and the heaviness of the tail is the main reason for us to bring here the mixture, actually. Mm-hmm. So we basically, that's another question I have on a discussion list later, is what other prior we can put the prior with heavy tails, but kind of a bit less cumbersome to work with when we go for linear combinations. Heavy tail prior closed form under linear combinations. But let's put it for later, right? Once we know the second and the fourth moment, we can actually just try to come up with some parametric family of the distribution and try to match the parameters so we end up with the same variance and kurtosis for that replacement distribution. It turns out that once if you have a mixture of two normal kind of the same analytical form as it's possible to find another prior and another weight in the mixture and another variance for the two component Gaussian distribution in a way that will exactly preserve the second and the first moment for our distribution.
But is it one dimensional?
It is one dimensional. As was our previous z score, right? It was one number, one dimensional random variable.
But before we had a one dimensional distribution which consisted of exponential relations.
Yes. And in this second lemma, I mentioned that I can, for that complex distribution with an exponential number of mixtures, I can still find its second and fourth moment. And now I would like to have another two-component distribution with exactly the same second and fourth moment.
You're trying to approximate the exponentially many number of components of mixture of Gaussians
mm-hmm.
with a two-component mixture of Gaussians where one component is fixed to be Dirac delta.
Yes,
And we have 3 degrees of freedom,
Just two. 2 degrees of freedom, P1, because P0 is 1 minus. Two and two parameters, two constraints.
And we are by definition have a zero mean.
Yes.
So and we have two moments. Yep.
Yes.
Second moment and fourth moment.
Yes.
2 degrees of freedom.
Yes. And it worked, right? So it turned out that there is no kind of corner cases as long as for any two numbers we can. These two numbers. These are the second and fourth moment. If we define the parameters pi1 and s. In this specific way, then we end up with the known second and known fourth moment. So it's comparing to what we've had from before, all of the like either 20,000 a mixture of 20,000 Gaussians, right, with sampling approach, or this crazy numeric integration that involves computing this really large number of products and how unstable is numerically unstable is this product, and then a numeric integration which also has some kind of and it's a numeric integration of the oscillating functions, so might converge, might not.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a theory on its own, right? This one was like it's pretty nice, and it worked quite well, except still not good enough. So we use this approximation to find an initial, like once we fit based on log likelihood. We use this to come up with initial point in space, and then we go for the full solution with convolution. So this most precise solution in order to like refine our parameters. It's nice to have different solutions to the, like maybe we can like move to the log likelihood, the optimization part. Right, so now we have a log likelihood. Now we have a way, like actually three ways to compute in log likelihood of our problem, right? And we can minimize, basically, now we can, work optimization is, we are not expert on optimization. What we end up with is the differential evolution algorithm, which we, like, I don't know, have you heard the differential evolution from before? It seems to be, I think the first choice for any kind of direct optimization would be the NedlerMed, right? The F-mean search in MATLAB, or the simplex method, right? Not the simplex method from the mathematical linear programming thing, but the simplex method.
You mean, zeros order.
Yes, zero order NedlerMed, I think. Sorry for not saying it right. So, but that one required you to specify the initial point in space to start the optimization from, which is tricky, right? So there is another zero-order method called differential evolution, which is really nice. You give it a region. It's more like it's a bit more of a global search method where you can. There is a set of in F-mean search NedlerMed, it's n plus one. That's your population size of the points in space that you use to optimize. Here it's more like a larger population in a global optimization algorithm. And so now we really numerically optimize our log likelihood function with respect to parameters. And we see that there is a pretty clear minimum in terms, for example, of pi1, right? So based on this simple log likelihood, we can minimize the find something, some reasonable parameters. But it's noisy, right? So that's why I discussed the three solutions to this problem, because it's like, you know, it's very hard to get. We have to, in our domain, we have to prove that something works in simulations. We generate data according to the assumptions of our model, and we have to prove that once we run the optimization on this data, we actually recover the unbiased estimates of the parameters. And like this is the profile of the like energy landscape of the log likelihood in 2D, right? Once we have pi and sigma beta, and 1D, for example, as a log likelihood as a function of one parameter, and we can easily be stuck in the local minima. For example, this one is noisy. So this data was from the sampling approach, right? So once you sample, obviously you introduce some noise to the energy landscape as well. Yes.
Oh.
Thank you. Yes. Yes.
You optimize the log likelihood, which you estimated somehow.
Yes.
And you estimated the very deep mixture of Gaussians as a mixture of two Gaussians.
Yes.
So here you compute the value of log likelihood of these two Gaussians. Yes?
Yes. Well, so let's go.
And I think it's like very not your function, because if you have a very, very much number of Gaussians in your mixture, it's not the mixture of two of them.
Mm-hmm.
So why are you let's
go back to the, like, maybe I didn't explain overall what's going on. So we have three parameters in this model, just three, right? And we have some observed data, but this data is not the actual parameters, right? There is the data is z-score. And I think I thought it should be like the straightforward approach. Once we have a parameters and we have observing some data, and then we maximize the likelihood of observing the data given parameters.
The only thing that is...
W. Okay, sorry for that. The W is weight, and the weight is a number. It's a fixed. I see. So the W confused you because it reminds of the EM algorithm. The W we do not optimize. The W is a fixed hard coded. I put it here because it's a very good question. Why we need a weighted log likelihood?
Yeah.
But the weights are hard coded.
Okay. So.
But the question was not about weights.
Yes. So yes.
And you estimated with a mixture of two Gaussians.
Yes.
Are you sure that this estimation is good?
Okay. Now I understand. That's good.
Of the different functions.
Of course. So that is it's not perfect. Definitely, same as any approximation. The only thing I know about this approximation is that it preserves the moments, right? It preserved two moments. Some people in this domain just preserve the second moment, the expectancy. We preserve two of them, but we don't know. It's like we run in extensive simulations. It's like 20 pages in the supplement, and we've like across many parameters, this approximation was reasonable, but only reasonable to serve as a supplementary helper to find initial point for. What we know is this is an exact solution, right? So we've used, for final optimization, we've used the convolution. So the Gaussian was a nice trick to speed up. It's nice to be able to compute, like, it's approximately 160 times faster. It's cost around 10 minutes to compute this thing once, like on a large server, and this one takes like seconds. So that was the reason for a performance improvement and some kind of ability to have a flexible fit procedure in this case. Yes. So I think this slide would be a good example. You see, it was noisy, right? In some case, and finding the gradients of the noisy function would be like even more noisy. So we've tried that, but we were not able to get any improvement in save time by using first order or second order method, because our our estimates of the gradient were noisy. Would that be a...
So, you have an estimation of a function that you want to optimize, that is noisy.
So our log likelihood is noisy, yes. Right, because like look here. So this one, this approach requires some kind of arbitrary number of samples. Depending on how many samples we have, we can make it quite smooth, right? And for example, this was pretty smooth surface, right? So I would this one was specifically computed with the first approach. It is pretty smooth, but if I can try to zoom in, it's a very like you see it's first there are some linear combination of parameters that seems to be not well identified. Right, this kind of black region Stroud, and then the noise was quite important. So it was difficult for optimizing method. So anyway, the reason for the noise is in this case it's a finite number of samples in our approximation. Here is the numeric integration, depending on parameter, the numeric integration here with cubature might take a slightly different route, right? And it's noisy. This one is absolutely smooth. However, it's an approximation, which is not good enough. So that's why we are optimizing the noisy log likelihood function. But, you know, so that's I know it's a hard problem. We really spent just two years trying to figure out at least some solutions that work, right? It's an important problem because like that's the only genetic data we have, and you see that like we start with 2 terabytes on disk of the data. The genetic matrix is really large scale genotype data, 2 terabytes. And now we are trying to estimate 3 parameters out of this data. And despite like different 3 approaches to computing the likelihood function, it still doesn't really so shiny. I would be happy to give an overview of the properly Bayesian methods that do the same, right? They also struggle with similar problems with very slow convergence, long time to compute.
At least try to suggest you one presumably quite efficient, computationally efficient technique for solving a problem.
Yeah.
I also have a question about motivation. Maybe I didn't get in the beginning. What we will do with that estimated PNC?
Good question. So first, it's very interesting from the domain perspective to interpret these numbers. The pi is a polygenicity parameter. It's like we know that some traits are Mendelian, like it's one gene explaining everything. Some traits are crazy polygenic, like schizophrenia. But pi is a very interesting quantitative measure that we can speak about. The larger pi, the more genes is involved, and that's interesting for people to compare. And the sigma beta is the effect size. It's interesting, like is this big or small effects involved? And the product of these two is the heritability. So we can, from this model, read out, is this trait heritable, like by 80% or by 1%? If it's 1, probably it's not interesting to study, right? And the last one, the sigma zero, is also interesting. But, and another thing, like let's look at, there are some posterior integrals. Once we've fitted the model and we know that the model kind of describes the data, we can estimate, like sort of, that's why this slide is mainly the reason why I think it might be interesting to discuss it in this group, because like we do use a very basic Bayesian posterior function, because okay, now what we have the distribution over Z, right? We have an observation of Z, and we are interested in the some posterior, let's say, expectancy of delta square, right? So like we're interested in this quantity, which is basically the proportional to the expectancy of delta to some power, like the 1 or 2, given our observation, right? So for that, we need a model, right? In order to make it happen, we need the probability distribution over Z and delta, kind of like as a joint distribution, right? And for example, this parameter was extremely interesting in a field.
Expectancy of delta to the power of q.
Yeah.
You mean expectation?
It could be, yes.
With respect to what distribution? To the posterior distribution over delta or not?
Yes.
Here up to constant.
Up to constant.
Multiple constant,
yeah.
It's true.
Yes. Sorry. Sorry for that. I'll try to speak in the microphone. So, and just I want to share this trick. You know, the I've integrated last time at the university. It's not that much effort I spend in integration. And this, to me, looks like pretty difficult. Of course, we won't go through deviation. And I can tell you, actually, I've never done that myself. I never derived these formulas. I just feed them into the Mathematica, the Wolfram Mathematica. It's so good at doing these integrals, right? It's really just amazing.
What is the quantity of S?
I don't want to overwhelm you. Like the S quantity, this ratio is telling us. So you see, it's about large Z scores, right? For large LD Z scores, what's the fraction of Z that was large, right? And basically the S number is how much we've discovered with our genetic studies. Mm-hmm. So this conceptually is if we just drop the dependency on the sample size, but obviously we have it, right? Because Z is a function of N, which is the number of participants in the study. So S as a function of N tells us at a sample size of 10 times larger, 100 times larger, once we get 10 million, 100 million people, how much would we be able to explain, right? And we feed the model and now we estimate the future of the field in few years from now, right? So that was, and you see, it's very interesting that once we, you remember, Z was really complex distribution. It's the one with the exponentially large number of components. But because one of our approaches was that simple to like do it as a mixture, that sum is a mixture, right? A mixture of normals, right? Then we can actually estimate this both denominator and numerator under this approximation. Right, so it feels like kind of going down to this shape of the approximation on Z distribution is really fruitful for us, because we can under this model we can estimate a lot of posterior functions, mm-hmm. Right? So, and that's just one of them. I had a bit more complex things for 2D, for really once, like that was all 1D, right? I think I will speed up a little bit because we need some time for the discussion at the end. So the paper here was actually about 2D. I started with 1D because you've seen it was kind of complex enough discussion, but we are interested in the cross-trait analysis, one we have for each marker Z1 in one trait, let's say schizophrenia, and Z2 in the bipolar disorder, and we are interested in like how they overlap. So I just skip through some figures that just to give you the feel of the data. In simulations, if the betas look like that, right, then Z will be look like in the bottom here. So it's now it's two traits, right? So probably hard to switch from just having one per variant to two. But the idea was, let's say if we have the genetic effects completely independent, like if something has an effect on one trait, it doesn't have an effect on the other trait, and the opposite, right? If something has, right? Then what we will observe in the space, like this is hidden, right? We don't know real genetics, right? This is the top line here is our simulations data. But then under these assumptions, that's what we will observe as a Z data that we can optimize for, right? And you see, it's pretty noisy. In reality, it looks like that. It's really like, I also like the visual appeal. It's like a star or something, but basically the Z scores for schizophrenia right now are between minus 10 and 10, right? And the bulk of them are really like uniformly distributed normal, noise. And if we plot them, like this is a density heat map between what we observe in the 1.3 million education study on education attainment versus like 100,000 study in schizophrenia. Yes, it seems that it's a white noise, right? Kind of not much data. Some outliers, right? So it's what's in the corner, that's pretty interesting, but you know, that's a little bit difficult to, I don't know, are you familiar with the QQ plot as a concept? In statistics, that's pretty, like quantile plots to assess whether two distributions have similar shape.
It's better to remind.
Yeah, so, this is our synthetic data, and it's not directly the very standard QQ plot will look something like that. Like you have Z1, you have, probably not the best. In statistics, for example, you typically need to test. Okay, let me do that. I think something like, no, the opposite, like this. So, Yeah. So, for example, in statistics, once you do the standard linear model, it's important to test that residuals of a linear model are normally distributed, right? And you can probably do a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test for normality, but on a large sample, it will always tell you, oh, yes, it's a little bit not normal, right? So what people do is they make a QQ plot. So they see the difference between the observed distribution of the residuals versus the like expected under the true assumptions, right, which is normal. So and then the plots look approximately like that. It's a quantile-quantile plot, so one of them don't know what people normally write on the axis. One of them is the actual z that they observe, and another one is an expected quantile under null. So you know, they sort the values, and yeah, probably not the best explanation. Anyway, so the standard one is on the natural axis, just z score versus z, right? This one is in log axis, so probably it'll be a little bit hard to understand what we plot the logarithm of the p value that we observe versus the logarithm of the expected p value under null, right? So if there is no signal, it will be flat, like kind of following the null. And the fact that it deviates, it means that in our sample we have an excess of heavy z-scores, right?
Because if it goes up.
If it goes up, like in all of the plots here. And there are really very bad colors here, but the blue one is the real data and the red one is expected from the model, because we can also plot the according to our model of the PDF of Z, how would it look like, right? So, and effectively, once we fit the parameters with log likelihood, we can kind of see that the curve actually starts describing the actual data, right? So the thing here is about we played with a pi parameter and we play with a h or sigma beta parameter. You see, the larger the sigma beta, the further it is from the null. Like low sigma beta, it follows the null. The larger it is, the more signal there is in the data.
And
right?
What's the difference between the columns?
Between the columns is different pi. So this is pi of 1%, pi of 0.1%, and 10 to the minus 5,
uh-huh.
Pi 1. Right? And we actually, so
and
this
pi is the probability of non-degenerates.
Yes. Yes, and like that's this is from synthetic data, but we've seen like all these cases in the real data. So, for example, the pi is very nice shape from here. It pi tells us where it will start to bend, right? Basically,
right?
Except there is this linear combination, right? So we put together through the linear combination, the actual proportion of things associated, because it's in Z space, right? I can go back into the concept.
What was its dimensionality?
Number of SNPs?
No, dimensionality of Z.
Yes. In this case, 11 million. So we have 11 million statistical tests, basically. And a lot of them are null. And in the tail, they're not null. So, yeah, that was like a nice way to look at this data in terms of like it's not, it looks pretty noisy, but in the end there is a small tail that is definitely a non-noise.
And, what is the dashed line here?
The dashed line is null. That would be under null. It's what we just plot as a reference. So the dashed line in this one, right? The dashed line is like, you know, that if we have a collection of the p-values under h null. At h0, they will be uniformly distributed on 0, 1, right? And if you look at the z-scores, if you have a collection of z-scores under h null, they will be distributed as a normal, right?
Yeah.
So that is the dashed line is how would the QQ plot looks like under null?
Under null?
Under h null for each of the tests.
Under normal distribution?
Under normal distribution, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So yes, at this point we can move to the kind of discussion part of this, kind of what we would like to do next with this thing. The first paper is out now. Interesting, like, is there a better prior? Because you've seen the three solutions we put to the prior. They are noisy, they are costly, they are not really good. Even though we spent some effort on it. So what we are looking after basically is the heavy tails, right? It's a heavy tail probabilistic function that is closed under linear combinations. Like I'm not probably forgotten everything I was told but I know the normals are closed, but they are not heavy tails. But so yeah, if you can think of any prior that would replace our strange mixture of delta and the Gaussians, that would be interesting. Another one is we're actually very interested to model the dependencies between different betas, right? So for us, they were independent. The different betas were like independent in terms of like as random variables. But like first, we already work at like a lot more complex prior when it's a mixture of four components and it's different sigmas and could be different pi's. And the sigmas could be modulated by whatever we know about the human genome, right? And the plots I've shown you from the 2D, we actually modeled as a mixture of four Gaussians, some kind of a little bit degenerative, and then the full Gaussian component. So that's one of the, we are playing with very different priors here. And one specific topic is, can we model the dependency between betas? Because like we know that the SNPs, basically the SNPs or these genetic variants belonging to the same, let's say, genetic pathway will behave similarly, right? There is so it, like bioinformatics is such a large field that they know a lot about the connections between different parts of the genome. For example, there is a pathway of neuronal differentiation. These are all genes involved in like whatever is going on with neurons when they split and kind of mature. Right, so we would like to put that as our prior on beta, and that's why. So maybe correct me if I'm wrong by saying that we had a prior on beta, right? So it's not a prior on meta parameters, but like we have our domain knowledge about how beta looks like. One of the things was that it's a heavy tail distribution, right? So that's why our prior knowledge was translated into the delta function plus the Gaussian. But we would like to put more things, and like what I'm thinking here is like more like I don't know. For example, in the topic modeling, right? When we model the relationship between documents and the list collections, it's nice to model the like authors, right? If someone cites someone else, right? Then there is a relationship between these two entities. So here we also would like to model the dependencies between betas. Because our prior so far, it's not the interdependency between beta. It's like we can say that, okay, in certain region, betas should have larger effect, right? That we can model with. So that's my project right now. I have the enrichment. In given regions, we expect betas to have larger pi or larger sigma, right? But what if we can say that these two betas are either both small or both large? That is interesting. And also you've seen that basically the posterior that I mentioned was about the deltas, right? So if you say that Z is equal to some kind of delta plus epsilon, right? Sorry, I don't have another slide, but so we found the expectancy of the delta, expectancy of the genetic component. But we didn't work out this correlation structure, the A, right, across SNPs. So that would be remember, what we actually kind of interested in here is to computing the betas themselves, right? With what I've shown today, we didn't address this question in any way. We said we put a prior on betas, and then we can estimate the parameters of the prior because it's like either helps us to answer some questions related to the domain, or we can basically interpret these parameters, the pi, the sigma beta, the sigma zero, but we did not in any way address the question, what are the actual betas themselves, right? So we would like to do this kind of pseudo, estimate A pseudo inverse times Y, or times, you know, here the G pseudo inverse times Y, right? At this scale, can we do that actually? Like some people say they can, but their tools are not quite promising. And that's like, if I have a chance to talk with an experts in the linear, like huge linear algebra, how do they approach this problem? It would be interesting because it's a block matrix, right? So maybe we can do something because that's a valid problem, right? We can estimate, given our observation of Z, we can probably like formulate this problem to estimate the beta itself, but solving it involves the pseudo inverse, and that one is really hard to do. So another big topic in this domain was mixed effect models, because our model today was just fixed random effects, right? We had only the random effects beta without zero, without a fixed mean, right? All our Gaussians throughout the whole presentation are zero mean, right? But it's definitely interesting to introduce some fixed effect in the model. Let's say, okay, what if we have a genetic variant that is, we would like to like model, is it increasing the height? Is it decreasing the height specifically for that given variant? Like, can we do something then? Because this whole domain is called mixed effect models, right? They have the restricted likelihood, restricted max likelihood, right? Because the problem is, so you know, who've just heard of the restricted max likelihood as a okay, then probably it's a separate, completely separate thing. You know, there's so many things going on in statistics, but it seems to be a huge domain with, like, 40 years back they had an algorithm called average information, and since then people come out with a whole bunch of other algorithms for fitting this. Yeah, so optimization is another topic. Right? So basically I'm just trying to brainstorm, right, since I came and bother you with this really kind of plenty of mathematical questions and details, and like what are the potential feedback points we can discuss. Other than that, actually, I can maybe mention how I can be helpful, because I think I'm pretty good at this last part with computing. So just to implement this stuff, we used a mix of Python and C++, and in C++ we definitely had to go for the OpenMPI to do it concurrently across threads, and then we had this numeric integration, just what we plugged in, but we spent for a bit of time compressing and storing this matrix. Originally it was like 70G in memory. Doesn't really work on our clusters with 64, so we compressed it down to 10 using small integer optimizations and etc. And like just working with some high performance instruction sets, etc., is pretty interesting. So if I really like these computational things. So I first don't want to go into detail right now, but it was nice. We started with MATLAB. Everything was coded in MATLAB originally, and then it just doesn't work. It is so custom and specific. Like MATLAB is a matrix laboratory. If you stay with matrix, it's really good. It has a lot of good algorithms. But if you have to code down to hardware, that's not that fun. And of course, we didn't touch on the like beta prediction, because if we have the beta hat, even the one that is naive, right? The beta hat that is just a correlation of the, like, the naive bias classifier is what 60% of the publication in this field are from the naive bias classifier, which people know under the name of the polygenic risk score. It's the estimates for a given variant that we like completely forget everything except for a given genetic variant, look for the correlation, come up with a beta hat that how this particular variant correlates with a phenotype. And then we disregard the correlation structure, everything, just in a very naive classifier way, sum them together, right? Still have some predictive performance, and that's what people use for all of that. That's kind of the mainstream genetic studies. And with these better priors on beta, maybe we can do the better estimation and better prediction, which is helpful. So that was the models. And with that, I just acknowledge my colleagues. We are a pretty large team, and this is Norman part, of course. Not everyone is working on genetics. You see, this is a large family. Like, for actually, some of them are really real family, because my wife is also here. But we also have colleagues on the other side of Atlantic, and the actual, like, the really guru who inspired this particular mixer thing was Anders Dale in the University of California in San Diego. We worked really hard with him, and just together tackling these nasty mathematical problems for us. So, yeah, I think that's it. Do you have some questions, either for this discussion that I put or back to the slides? Like, yeah, any questions? Yes.
You mentioned that you want to optimize your code in a way. Which compiler are you using now?
I've ended up with just GCC.
Well, yeah. GCC, use Pentel compiler, two times better.
Yes. I've been on the trainings from Intel, and they don't say that anymore.
What?
I've been on trainings with Intel, and they don't say that anymore. So for some things, I again, yes, it could be faster, but I
I
think it depends on, I also tested on some, it depends on the code, right?
It depends on for the code and the optimization we're using, and if you want to really push it to the max use Intel and Intel x86, utilize your CPU, and you can use HX 512.
Not available in our cluster, sorry.
Yeah. Anyhow, using Intel compiler.
But code also right should support that, right? So it's again, it's always a balance. Like, I have a limited time I can spend on it, right? So I know I can probably tweak maybe 20% more of performance, but yeah, you're right. That's a good point. I had on the list to I need to see if Intel straight away is available in our cluster to yeah. I know, but that's installed in it, and I've also, like, for this stuff, I've tried, for example, using MKL for the things I could. I tried to use MKL, it wasn't at my faster. Yes, yeah. No, but if you call MKL, right? It's a dynamically linked, then what's again? It's a good point. We could try. We could try and see. It's after all, it's an empirical question, right? I'm aware of the Intel compiler. It's definitely a good thing, but. Yes, so my colleague was, I think, 1 year he called it everything in Julia. I think at the end he switched to C because it was, some libraries are not available. The good thing is Python, it's so, like, the NumPy, CPy, everything is already available. Julia is an excellent thing, but so we don't mind this mix. We don't mind having the core performance modules in C++, and then it's like integrated into Python. So Python is for high level, like data logistics and like smart things like fitting the model, and then the actual hardcore stuff is in C++. Yeah. But it's interesting. I like code. Everything is public, so this stuff is public. It's all the research code, you know, the research code and the production code. But
Well, I had a question about, does it buy anybody tried to learn a nonlinear model? Because, well, currently data analysis, almost nobody learns linear model. They were somehow compromised. They are not able, they're too weak to capture the real dependence in our data. And here you learn linear model.
Yes, that's a good, absolutely. I've been thinking why. Why, like, you look at the papers and they don't. So in domains, it's called epistasis, the interaction term between the different genomic locations. So, and one of them is like this structure. You would definitely expect nonlinear effects within the block, within one block, but probably not across blocks, because if there is a genetic effect that is nonlinear, that's like different chromosomes, right? Things interacting on different chromosomes is difficult because they're independently inherited. So what I have, I get from my mother and from my father. If there was something important biologically, right, I should have passed it to the next generation, but the fact that the chromosome in our body is this continuous 1D structure that randomly goes to the next generation, it must break whatever there is, whatever dependency across between features we have. If it breaks across generations, then probably it would not survive the evolution, right? So there is explaining that is. I think in order to have an interaction, you have some kind of unit that survives when it goes from the parents to kids, right? Otherwise, we are interested in interactions within one block, because the fact that within things that are like highly correlated and go together, like from like per father to from parents to kids, that is interesting. On a different chromosome, so remotely on one chromosome, I feel linear model could be the right biological. Kind of.
But anyway, does there exist any paper that actually try to learn this nonlinear?
Not to my like, I can look it up the exact papers, because the term is in the field. People use it in not in this complex. So this whole thing was about complex polygenic disorders when the individual effects are small, but they are scattered across many genes. If you talk about the Mendelian traits, when like there is a very known functional broken protein that causes very like severe dysfunctioning, then I think people do study the nonlinear, but not throughout the whole genome. Like in this case, for some, like partially the level, like this model is hard enough to learn, so we kind of don't jump on a more complex problem before we feel like this one is under control. Another thing is this biological reasoning, that it's only the things that go together from parents to kids that it's, maybe you can, in other words, let's say there is like some interaction that gives, if you speak of the height, right, how tall is someone, right? If it's not a linear combination of the gene I have, right, but then it's actually, the genes from me to my daughter goes independently, right? So how it kind of don't match the non-linear. It's only, so whatever is linear, that preserves, right? If there is something giving me an extra centimeter of height, right, and some other parts of the chromosome that gives another two, right, and then they go independent. Whether they go or not, they still kind of additively add to the height of the next, of the offspring. So I think there is a pretty solid biological justification for the linear model, except when we talk for the one block, or if you talk, yeah. but
okay. Are there any more questions?
Speaking about a more heavy-tailed prior that is, as you said, closed under linear transformation, right? Well, I think that Cauchy is closed under linear transformation.
Cauchy, mm-hmm. Cauchy distribution.
It's like the most heavy-tailed distribution.
Is it parametric?
Yes, of course. And it has a much much more simple parametric form than even normal distribution.
You can try. Is it one or two parameters? Just
shift and scale.
Yeah. So for us, the shift would be zero, right? Shift would be zero, so it's one, right? And that's, so I think here it was quite important that it's two parameters. So one affects like how heavy, how large is kurtosis versus how much variance do we have, because these are two independent properties that
kurtosis and variance.
Yeah. So in some sense, this was.
What about using the mixture of delta function plus Cauchy?
We could try, because now the mass that we presented was pretty flexible to that. So we can try. Yes.
The only problem is that for Cauchy, we do not. There doesn't exist any of the first moment. Not talking about the second one. So mm-hmm. No moments exist. For
yes.
Cauchy.
Yeah. Okay. So that.
Okay, well, I think that that's at least worth discussing.
And just if you're I'm happy to share slides, and if you would like to, everything is written down in the supplement of this paper. It's actually, some things were cumbersome because it's the first time in 3 years I was given a chance to speak about the actual math behind it, because it's always like presenting it to like the domain expert, it's not about math, it's about the interpretation and everything, right? So therefore everything is in supplement. There is nothing of what we discussed into the main text. Like this is a paper, the supplement has all of the stuff if you're interested in. Thank you.
Okay, so let us thank the speaker for a very interesting talk.